Good morning, coffee drinkers. The Snowman here, and I, bit of an announcement to make. New book is out today. The link is below. It's the sequel. It's the follow-up to All the Good Stuff. This is All the Better Stuff. It's right here, and you can get your copy below. There's a link in the description to this video, and back kind of old school today with the vlog, and we're doing a Facebook Live Q&A. Had some really awesome questions. I played the new bass a bunch. Old school daily vlog. Haven't done one of these in so long. It was great to hear the questions. Let's get right to that. And a full vlog about the new bass and my trip to Sweden and all that stuff with Anders Mattisson is coming up in the next couple of days before Christmas. Again, the link to the new book is below. Happy holidays and enjoy the Q&A. This is a great opening question. It's from Sven Henriksen, and he asks, do you have an album you've recorded or recorded on that you are musically the most proud of? It's a great question because that list is really, really small. I think that is a list of exactly one album. as hard as that may be to believe, I really didn't feel comfortable on somebody else's record until pretty recently, until just like a couple of years ago, when I played on Peter Erskine's Dr. Recording, which just to me was fun. Number one, really fun band, really fun music. Always great working with Pete and Bees and Shep and all those guys. And just, it was the first time in my career that I sat and listened to the mix and thought, wow, I actually really like this. And I was very proud of the way I played on the record. I guess that's another thing, like I've put out records on my own, obviously 7 or 8 records. And there are moments where I think, oh, that was cool. And the great, great moments with the guys in the band and where things kind of came together as I maybe planned them, or there were some nice surprises. I think with It Only Happens Once, that the fact that that album was completely improvised was a great example of, you know, moments that happened that I had no idea they were gonna happen. And I thought, oh, that was really cool. And it felt good at the time. I don't tend to go back and listen to my own music so much after the fact. Yeah, I guess the short answer to your question is that yes, there is one album, and it was the Peter Erskine Dr. Record from a couple of years ago. Next question is from Alex Burns, who asks, how do you pluck with your hand turned like you do? Are there advantages to that besides palm muting? I guess you're asking about this way of playing instead of like having my elbow up and playing kind of more traditional approach. Yeah, it's just way more relaxed, number one. I think that's the biggest part of it. And yes, palm muting is a big advantage there. I can get to palm muting way easier in this position, but it lowers my right elbow. It takes some tension off the right shoulder and gives me a lot of range in terms of false harmonics, in terms of being able to play double stops. In fact, let me put that in the looper. That'll give you an idea. I can kind of give you an idea of all the things I can do in that position. So really easy to play tense and get like a nice chord thing going in there. Percussive kind of things as well when I'm muting with the left hand. And then I just feel like I have a pretty big range. You know, I'm in control, and there's a bigger dynamic range when my hand position is like this with the right hand. Thank you. kind of false harmonic stuff as well. I guess the easiest way to put it is that I feel less restricted when I'm in that position. That's not to say that I don't, you know, get the elbow up a little bit and dig in. You know, and play that kind of style as well. Dom Kingswood, any word on the Australian tour? No word on the Australian tour right now. I just completed a project, we're almost finished with a project with Adrian Portia. So there should be some dates in Australia with that in 2018. But as far as the last minute world tour thing, it just didn't work out in August, September when I was planning for it, which was sad. But that's the reality sometimes. It doesn't always work out and the dates didn't line up. So I'm always looking for opportunities and looking for a time to do it, but so far, right now, nothing concrete and planned. Okay, Sammy McKenzie asks, what does your daily routine consist of? Do you plan your day? I'm guessing you mean kind of bass specific or music specific when you ask that question. Absolutely, I do not plan my day. But what I do have are a lot of options, depending on whether I have 20 minutes, 3 hours, you know, if I have music I really have to work on for a tour or for a gig, maybe for a recording, maybe a composition I need to finish writing, whatever it might be, you know, shooting videos for the bass studio. I do have a lot of options for things to work on. So it's more a question of looking at the time I have, you know, seeing how my schedule is budgeted, and then filling that time accordingly. But there's no real set thing that I do every day. I just have a lot of options. And that's kind of what the new book, big plug for the new book here. Obviously, it just came out. All the better stuff. It's the follow-up to All the Good Stuff. That's kind of what that's about. Just showing you guys more of the things that go into my routine. This one, here's All the Good Stuff. This is, as I announced about a week ago, this one is done. This is finished. All the Good Stuff is no longer. This version, we are doing a reissue, a second edition of it. In fact, Chelsea is working on it right now. Hi, babe. Chelsea's over here. She's working on it, like, right this minute, but it looks amazing. It's like an update, the new cover, new editing, lots of 12 key things, tab. It's just a much improved version of All the Good Stuff. So that's what's in All the Good Stuff and the new book that came out today, All the Better Stuff. Those are the kind of things. Those are my options, you know, the many options that I'm constantly evolving, constantly coming up with. I don't like to be bored when I practice. I fall, like everyone else falls into the thing of playing the same things over and over again. So there are certain things. There was one thing that I couldn't believe didn't make it in All the Good Stuff 3 years ago, which was this simple. Really simple major tonality thing in triads, in triplets. It's really, really simple, all diatonic. Can't believe that didn't make it into All the Good Stuff, but it's in All the Better Stuff. And there are certain things like that that I've played so many times that I continue to do so because they're a real easy muscle memory go-to element of my practice routine. And I'll more often than not use those things that are super familiar as the warm-up and then get into whatever it is that I need to work on. And like I always say, it's time and sound over everything, two most important things. So those are always the big focal points, no matter what the content is I'm working. Oh, this is a good question from Jose Figueroa. Yeah, Jose Figueroa, who asks, hey Janek, how long is your process from initially hearing a musical phrase that you want to be in possession of through its practice phases and to it finally coming out naturally in your playing? Wow, that really varies. One thing I will say, and one thing I try and stick to, is if I've been practicing something during the day and I have a gig that night, I really won't try and play that idea on the gig. I won't force the issue. I really want to let it come out naturally in my playing, and there's no set amount of time. It does take me a long time with a lot of things for them to seep into my playing and for them to become like a natural extension of my vocabulary, I will say that. But yeah, just not forcing the issue and being okay with spending a ton of time working on that stuff. Not forcing the issue, not rushing, not having any anxiety or tension when I'm working on things. Max Chrisman asks, not sure if it has been mentioned or if you can even talk about it yet, but any idea of how much the signature bass will roughly cost? I keep getting a lot of questions about this and a lot of like dumb comments on my social media feed as well. about that stuff, because we haven't announced the price yet. People are preconceiving what that might be, and I'm super happy that they're like going way over what we're talking about making it, and just we haven't settled on the exact price yet. It's not going to be tiny money, like a couple of hundred bucks, but it's also not going to be like, you know, $10,000 or $15,000 either, and there are going to be different options depending on your budget. So we're really trying to think of everyone here. There's not just going to be one signature bass. We're working on two different things. One's going to be slightly different, double cut, five string with possibly a PJ setup that will be cheaper than the single cut. So there are going to be options. I can't talk about it yet, simply because, not that I'm not allowed to, simply because we haven't decided upon what it's going to be yet. This is a prototype, and we are in the pretty much in the embryonic stages of making this thing happen. Although the process now will be fairly accelerated as we move forward, and as we've had this initial like really good session working with Anders over in Sweden, and I will be going back in February to like to complete some things. So yeah, hang tight, and we will get you that information as soon as possible. Great question from Chris Perlberg, who asks, what do you think the most important secondary non-musical skill is for a working musician? I actually don't think it's secondary. I think the secondary skill is the music. I think the what you might consider to be the secondary skill, which I consider to be the primary skill, is dealing with people. And it is a skill I have not even come close to being good at, never mind mastering. And it's something I struggle with every day, I think. Something I struggled a lot more earlier on in my career with. And I think I've got to the point now where I've kind of decided that I'm going to be who I am, and I'm not going to try and fit myself into a bunch of different molds. Like, I'm not going to try and be the super studio guy, the super touring guy, or the super this or super that, you know, and really be someone that I'm not, which I did definitely try to do early on because I wanted work and I wanted to be hired. That's not my personality, and that's totally okay. And for some people, that totally is their personality, and they can play a multitude of different roles. You know, one of my favorite examples of someone who is incredibly happy at playing an insane amount of different roles as a bass player is Nathan East. You know, and not just Nathan, but you think of someone like Will Lee, just any of these really great studio guys and touring guys and session guys, and they really have that capacity to deal with a multitude of people. And I just finally realized and admitted to myself that I didn't have that ability, and I still work on it for sure. But I think that's probably the primary skill, not even a secondary skill, that we should all have as musicians. You know, I think the music business, music industry, whatever you want to call it, is about 10% music and about 90% dealing with people. So people skills definitely a massively important skill. Connor Doherty asks, how is the new bass going? The new bass is going awesome. And you can feel free to ask as many questions about that as you like, because then that means I can play it a little bit more. Specifically than me just playing the bass, it feels great. It's a different shaped neck a little bit. It's more of a D rather than a C. That's a little thicker than what I've been used to playing. It feels great. It has the little, it's not an F hole, because an F hole is shaped like an F, like on a jazz guitar or something. But this note, when you blow it, actually plays an F. So that's my F hole. It is chambered throughout like half the body. So very different, very, very nice to play. And I haven't put it down. Charles?
Yeah.
I haven't put it down, right?
No.
I don't know if that was a no because she hasn't got to play it much, or a no because she's sick of me practicing already, but.
You only touched it twice.
Okay, so it was a no because she hasn't really played it much yet. But Chelsea has a new bass coming. We're excited about that this week. There's going to be some vlogging coming up in the next 10 days, so much. And I will do the whole vlog with the trip to Sweden and the whole bit, and hanging with Anders and being in the workshop and you know, putting the second pickup in, all of these things, that is coming in a vlog very soon, in just a couple of days. Samuel McKenzie says, really digging the artwork on the new book. You can thank Chelsea for that, because she is just superstar with that. Yeah, she's like, really? She's sitting there working on the artwork for the physical book. Yes, that's right, physical books. It's going into CreateSpace to Amazon tonight. Should be about 48 hours before, or 72 hours, something like that, before physical books are available. Oh yeah, oh dude, give me this. So, all right, let's do the rest of the, oh man, this thing is so soft. He's gonna hang out right here. Gonna do the rest of the Q&A with the snowman, cause it's Christmas. And trust me, I live in Southern California. We live in Southern California. There ain't no snow to make one of these bad boys. So you have to buy it at your local Vons or Pavilions. Josh Grevin asks, what are your thoughts on starting an online course in this day and age with heaps of competition and also gaining popularity online? Well, I think if your goal is to gain popularity online, then you're probably in it for the wrong reasons. I don't think the day and age or the competition really has anything to do with the outcome or the possibility of your success. I think that if you truly want to help other people and that's the motivation behind what you do, then people will come to you. You know, they will come to the source of that energy and that inspiration. And I think that's any time I've ever had positive feedback from anything I do online, that is generally at the root of it. You know, people are genuinely connected with what I do. I do it from a place, you know, the most honest place I possibly can. And I try not to bullshit my audience. I think as long as you have that and you have that peace of mind and satisfaction with what it is you do, regardless of monetary gain or likes, subscribes, comments, followers, any of that kind of stuff, then you're in a great place. And I don't think there's anything wrong with starting any kind of venture, be it music, online course related, or any other digital content delivery. Rod asks, have you been spending any time with Chelsea's six string F bass? When are you getting one? Hey babe.
Yeah.
Can you give me the bass? Yeah. She was just walking into her office and here it comes. Oh, here we go. Wow, so what do all these things do? Woo, it feels so weird. I think the snowman probably have better luck playing it than I do right now. Anyway, this is the last question I'm gonna put on the vlog camera. Carl Cerner asks, besides all the session work you've done over the years, how did you come about doing a solo album and becoming more of an extensive soloist? Well, I kind of had this goal that I wanted to make my first solo record by the time I was 25. I'd always been inspired, but of course, by Jaco and the fact that he made his first album, you know, the Jaco one on Epic Records. He made that pretty early on. And then I'd been around, you know, my mentor in the UK, Lawrence Cottle, and I'd kind of watched him make a couple of records. And I was just always, I always had compositions. I always had these melodies and these ideas, and I wanted to get them out, you know. And I think by the time I was getting towards my mid-20s, I'd realized, you know, what I talked about earlier on about knowing I didn't, you know, it was like square peg in a round hole and I just couldn't push myself into those other situations because that wasn't who I was. I think I was really just discovering that I was more of a composer and an artist and a soloist. So it was a pretty straightforward decision for me. It wasn't crazy. And then I, you know, managed to maintain session work and touring work outside of that as you know, as the years have gone by. So it's been, for the most part, a pretty healthy balance musically and career-wise, I would say, over the years.